سلام عرض می‌کنم خدمت دوستان خیلی ممنون که تشریف آوردین. Good afternoon everyone. Thank you for coming this evening despite the short notice. My name is Puya Azadi and I'm the manager of Stanford Round 24, the project. In case you haven't heard about what we do, the Round 24 project is a relatively new initiative at Stanford, co-sponsored by the Iranian Studies Program and CDDRL. And what we want to do is to make a platform for the Iranian diaspora scholars, such as our brilliant speaker today, to come and work together, collaborate, and create an insights and understanding about the status quo and future trends of the Iranian economy. We have a website if you're interested to know more about what we do, what we have done in the past. You can check that out. I just introduced say a few words about my dear friend, Tara Shirvani. Tara is currently at the World Bank, working on large scale infrastructure investment projects with the World Bank Group, with a focus on urban transport and road construction, as well as low carbon energy projects in the Middle East and Africa. Dr. Shirvani was born in Austria. She is also practically Iranian. And she's an engineer by training and her PhD in fuel and vehicle technologies from Oxford. And also she has a master's degree in engineering in sustainable development from Cambridge University. Before World Bank, Tara has worked for the UN in Iran, as well as Citigroup and Deutsche Bank. Dr. Shirvani has several featured articles in Foreign Affairs, The Economist, The Times of London, The New Statesman, and Harvard International Review. She speaks half a dozen languages and including Farsi, and she was honored as Global Shaper by the World Economic Forum in 2012, and in 2016 as Forbes 30 Under 30 Award, and then recently recognized by the French government as one of the global female rising talents of 2017. So please.
Thank you so much, Priya. Hello, everyone. I'm glad to see so many interested faces today. Let me express my gratitude first to the Hamid and Christina Murad program in Iranian Studies at Stanford University, to my dear friend Puya, and also to Dr. Milani for the opportunity to be here today and speak and tell you a little bit more about what I do about at the World Bank, what it means for the Middle East region, and what we have in store in terms of programs and policies in order to do something sustainable against climate change. But before I start, I want to tell a little story about my time at Oxford, and Priya may know that we were in the same research group at Oxford, and my supervisor at the time was Sir David King. He was the head of the department, and he was chief scientific advisor to Tony Blair and Gordon Brown. And I remember I came to Oxford and I was like a greenhorn. I didn't have really any idea about making the best presentation and what it means to be successful in this presentation or not. And I remember Sir David once told me that the only way you can measure if you were successful as part of your presentation is by measuring the amount of questions you get at the end of your presentation. If your audience didn't ask any questions, then you have to go back and work all night on it again to make sure that it's interesting enough so people ask questions. So me, of course, I don't really, as a proud Iranian, even though I was born in Austria, I don't like to fail. So I took a head start and I thought I'm going to start with a quiz to get the audience involved and see what are the kind of crowdsourcing answers we can get to see what the folks think about the World Bank. So, World Bank, who are we? There are three answers. Answer one, the World Bank is like a cooperative. made up of 189 member countries. These member countries, or shareholders, are represented by a board of governors who are the ultimate policymakers at the World Bank. Or what is the World Bank? Is it answer two? It is an institution run and operated by the US government, which is instrumental in shaping the structure, mission, and flow of funding. Or is it three? The World Bank holds the United States as the world's largest creditor and is led by the G7 countries in giving strategic direction, headquarters, and policy recommendations. What are we thinking? Who raises the hand for answer number one? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Okay. Number two. 1. Okay. So number three. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Six times two. We had your number. We had your hand once again, right? Okay. And the rest is, I guess, maybe all of it. So the answer actually is. It's not working.
The projector.
So.
Answer one actually. So the World Bank, we're like a cooperative made up of 189 member countries, and we're represented by a board of governors. And the governors which sit on our board are mostly the Minister of Finance or the Minister of Development of each member country, which is part of the World Bank Group. And they sit together at the annual meetings of the World Bank and decide the policy directions of the bank and also decide on who is going to be the next president of the World Bank. And then each country recruits an executive director. The executive director of the country is the leading voice to liaise between the government and the World Bank. In the case of Iran, it is one of the examples where the country is bundled up with other countries together, because by itself it wouldn't have the same veto power as other countries. One would think that Iran is bundled with other regional powers, like Arab countries, but actually for many countries it's a very diverse mix. In the case of Iran, it is together with Afghanistan, Algeria, Ghana, Morocco, Pakistan, and Tunisia. So it's a very diverse mix of countries that come together. But the Board of Governors of the World Bank at the end signs every project that we do to say, okay, we're going to invest in this country $200 million to build 75 schools. What do we do at the World Bank? So the World Bank is not really a bank in the ordinary sense of things. We're more like a partnership with the aim to reduce poverty and support development. What we provide is financing, which is low interest loans, zero to low interest credits, grants, but we also do a lot of advisory services and technical assistance. So we try to, on the one side, build capacity within each country to help the governments move towards sustainable solutions, but in other countries we're also available to provide funding, which is cheaper than otherwise provided. Question number two, what is the mission of the World Bank? Is it one, a world free of hunger? Is it two, ending extreme poverty? Is it three, getting a financial return on our loans and investments, because we're still a bank? Or is it four, promote shared prosperity? What do we have for one? No one. Two? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Three? Okay, no bankers in the room. Four, promote shared prosperity. Okay. So actually, both of you are right, because we have twin goals which are making up the vision of the World Bank. And the vision of the World Bank is really around reaching these two goals until the year 2030, which is one, ending extreme poverty by decreasing the percentage of people living on less than $2 a day, but also increasing the shared prosperity and the income growth for everyone that's part of the 40% of the bottom of every economy in the country. Question number three, where does the World Bank get its money from? Is it one, through its own equity and from money borrowed in the capital markets through the issuance of World Bank bonds? Is it two, through contributions from developed and middle-income partner countries? Is it three, through borrower repayments of credits plus interest? Or is it four, through privatizing natural resources in countries, receiving aid and selling them to private investors? Number one? No one? One, okay, good. Number two, contributions from developed and middle-income partners. Okay, a bit more, okay. Number three, repayments of credits plus interest. Okay. And number four, privatizing natural resources and selling them to private investors. Okay, okay. Actually, it's a mix of things. It's a mix of all three of these things. And it very much depends on kind of the structure of the World Bank group. Because the World Bank, in the traditional sense of thing, is actually not one bank. It's an entity of five different institutions that go hand in hand. And each different institution has a different way of fundraising money. So for example, these five entities are called the IFC, the International Finance Corporation. That's the part of the World Bank which actually invests only in private sector companies in the developing world. Then you have MIGA. MIGA is the company, is the part of the World Bank which provides guarantees for investments. So for example, if there is a company that is interested in investing in a bridge in Congo but is really afraid of the political risk and says, hey, I'm not sure if I'm going to get my money back if I go to Congo, but the World Bank will give you a guarantee to say, if you're willing to go ahead with this deal, then you have a World Bank guarantee that protects you against political risk, risk of default, credit risk, etc., etc. And then the other two big parts are the IBRD and IDA. IBRD is the International Bank for Reconstruction and Development, and IDA is International Development Association. And these two parts really make up for the chunk of all the credits and the loans and the guarantees that the World Bank is giving. In total, that was, I think, in year 2015, it's an annual budget around $60 billion that is invested. But it's quite important to know the difference a little bit of that, because it really depends on where you fall as a country to ask for what kind of money. The IDA, this is the International Development Association, really is like the world's largest multilateral source of concessional financing. And concessional financing really goes to the world's poorest countries in terms of grants or credits. So these loans that we're giving as part of IDA actually have market rates which are substantially lower than countries which can afford it than to get from the capital markets. And concessionality also means that the grace periods are substantially longer. So for example, if you're a country like Bangladesh and you would like to invest in 30 schools in a rural area of Bangladesh, and you're trying to find the money, but you realize that actually if I go to the capital markets, no one really believes that I can pay it back. It's very difficult, the money is very expensive. The World Bank is here to give you either a grant, so you don't ask for the money back, or it's a concessional loan, which have either an interest rate that is zero, or that would be almost close to zero. The maximum that I've seen is around 3%. And then the repayment is stretched for a very long time. So Bangladesh actually has upped between 25 and 40 years to pay back the World Bank the amount that we're giving them for building their schools. Even after those years, let's say 40 years pass, and Bangladesh is still in a crisis and says, oh, I still cannot pay, they still have a grace period that can stretch up to another 10 years. So the terms are significantly better than you would get for anything that you would get at the market. The other the commitment was around $20 billion for the year 2015. And then you have the other part that is IBRD. And IBID is really for the middle to low-income countries that are developing. So these are countries that really have a higher level of growth, most of the countries in Europe or Eastern Europe now that have stronger growth rates. So they were able to kind of ask for money from the World Bank at a higher interest rate. And for the IBRD, what we're doing is kind of we're getting the money for investing in the project from the capital markets. So we're issuing bonds. These bonds are very, very reliable. And there is this kind of self-sustaining mechanism that there is enough money available for providing funding for countries that fall into IBRD. But it's kind of more of a structural way of thinking about IDA and IBRD, because in the end, if you work for the World Bank, you can do projects in IDA, IBRD, you sit in the same office, you know, there's no separation between the two. But it's very important for a country when they're asking for a loan on the which category they're falling, because if it's too expensive to get an IBRD loan, such as for China now, then they're just going to go ahead and either build their own bank or they're going to go to the capital markets. This is a graph that shows you a bit the breakdown of the money for IBRD and IDA. And you can see the share of total lending, which was in the year 2015 around $43 billion, mostly went regionally to Africa and East Asia and Pacific. Really, it's like Africa is really at the kind of at the stepping point of really developing, but there's still a lot of fragile and conflict states. They need a lot of assistance. And if we have time, I will show a 4-minute video of the reality on the ground of what it actually looks like to work in Africa and try to build a road, especially in South Sudan. So it's a very interesting video to kind of give you an idea what it really means and why we're even there.
And you mentioned East Asia and Pacific. It means mostly is Vietnam, Burma, and those countries, not Japan, and because East Asia become...
Exactly. So Japan is too rich for us. So what Japan does is actually collaborates a lot with the World Bank when it comes to providing advisory services, when it provides to creating trust funds. It's more on like knowledge exchange rather than asking for funding.
And Iran is in, mostly can get in IDA or IBRD?
That's a great question. I will get to that in two slides from now. But basically, Iran would be, I think Iran is most likely IBRD, given the growth that they're having. But it's also been since 2005 that we have not worked with the World Bank in terms, with the World Bank in terms of funding yet. It's been a very long time that all the lending activities with Iran has been actually put on freeze. And I'm going to go into detail for why and where we are right now. But it's a great question. Sectorally, what you can see is the share of total lending, it's quite diverse. But if you put it together and you say infrastructure, which is energy, mining, transport, water, all of these things, they make up in total around 20% of the revenue of the World Bank. So the whole bulk of investment comes by building all these heavy infrastructure projects that really drive the revenue of the bank. But of course, there's a big part which also works on governance and reforming of parliaments, education, health services. It's a very diverse industries that they're working in. If you were asking yourself who are the ones that are actually borrowing the most from the bank, in the year 2014, it was most certainly India, one of the BRIC countries, had huge growth levels and was in a very good position to actually ask for a lot of financing from the World Bank in very good terms. It reached $2 billion just in 1 year. And it's really quite impressive because if you go there, they have these mega projects which reach like $1.2 billion and they're like renovating the whole road network of the largest provinces that they have in India. And then there's China, of course, right behind it, and this is from 2014. It's quite interesting because now in this year, 2017, we have actually very little demand from China to work with us, because they've become so self-sustaining and so strong, and they built their own bank now, development bank, the Asian Infrastructure Bank. And so now they're more in a trend of, it makes more sense that we use our own money to invest in China and in Africa than ask them to work with the World Bank. So it's very interesting, and it's also a very tense time for the World Bank, because it's almost a bit like an existential crisis. You know, where do we belong? Do we still have a place in the world? Are we too big to fail? You know, we're too bureaucratic. These are all the problems that we're facing, and actually it puts us in a very difficult position, so we have to rethink where we belong as part of the 21st century, really. This is a little bit the summary of where World Bank and Iran stand. You can see that the commitments that the World Bank has made to Iran actually ended in the year 2012. Which means that if it ended in 2012, it means that's the last year where the investment was made and something was built. But the year the last project was prepared was in the year 2005. And you can see that the commitments there were reaching almost 500 million in total. And most of the projects that were operated actually in Iran were more on the housing side, more on the urban side, especially sewage projects in the area of Tehran were very, very large. They had done a lot of investments in water sanitation. Also in terms of land management. And after 2005, it was not that we like completely stopped due to political reasons to work with Iran, but then it was more on an emergency basis. So we actually invested a lot of money as part of a DPO loan, which is a fast way of us giving money to a country when there was the earthquake in Bam, and the World Bank was able to provide financing to the government. There are still seats here at the front, if you would like to join. So in a way, Iran is still present. It has a voice, especially now after the sanctions the Iranian ED was quite keen on reigniting the relationship with the Iranian government. And there are certainly a lot of priorities that they're looking at. One of them is in the area of energy efficiency, and they're trying to do a lot of work, especially when it comes to flare gas recovery. It's one of the very obvious areas that they're strongly pushing for engagement. And then the same when it comes to the areas of water management, sewage, agriculture. These are the areas that are very kind of interesting for Iran and the World Bank to continue its dialogue. So as part of my second part of my presentation, I wanted to go a little bit more into detail about, like, now that you know what the World Bank looked like in a nutshell, what do we really do? What do we really do, for example, in the Middle East that is really a hot topic for us now? And how can we actually help? And I wanted to present the climate action plan that the World Bank has done for the Middle East as part of the COP negotiations that have been completed in the last round in November, and kind of highlight some of the challenges that the region is facing, stressing how these challenges will particularly be daunting given the already fragile conditions in the Middle East, and then how we try to help as part of the World Bank. So as we know, according to the established models, temperatures will rise and rainfall will decline a lot in the Middle East and North Africa. Droughts will be longer, deeper, and a lot more frequent. And the region will be very, very vulnerable. The models show us that the warming in the Middle East will be substantially higher than the global average that we experience in other parts of the world. But secondly, and most importantly, the region starts from an already very bad situation as the world's most water-stressed region of the world. We actually expect, which is quite worrying, that the rainfall projections will decline between 20 and 40% in a 2-degree world. And if we're not able to reach targets for a 2-degree world, which actually is very likely now, we're gonna expect a reduction in rainfall of around 60%. So it's going to be very harshly testing for the region. What does it mean in terms of GDP growth? What does it mean in terms of job creation? Well, actually 60% of the Middle East and North Africa's population, and also 70% of the region's GDP, are located in a high or extremely high water stressed area. So you can see that the whole Middle East region is very, very prone to water stress. And the 70% that the Middle East is actually sensitive to compares badly, significantly badly, than the global average, which is around 20%. So you can also see that the percentage of the population living in the Middle East, the world global average is around 36%, but for the Middle East, we're around two-thirds, around 60%. So it's a big problem. The other problem is that the disproportionate impact that climate change will have on the Middle East. And we can also see it from looking at the growth perspective in different countries. It's very obvious that almost 70% of agriculture, in the agricultural production in the Middle East, requires rain. And this sector is highly vulnerable to temperature and precipitation changes. So this also means, if you look at the temperature rises across the Middle East, that the economic impact will vary significantly among each other different countries. So the poorest and the most agriculturally based countries will actually be the one most vulnerable to the effects of climate change. The worst effect is now in Yemen. You can see that actually in Yemen already, in some parts of the country, there is barely any water. The projections are that by the year 2050, we will have a drop in GDP from Yemen due to climate change of almost 25%. So that's really like wiping out a whole country, pretty much. The same issue has actually already been seen in Syria, because the most vulnerable Syrians depend on agriculture substantially. And nearly 75% were affected by total crop failure in some parts of Syria. But that meant actually that a lot of people started migrating because of climate change. And around, I think around 1.3 million people in Syria were affected by the effects of the climate changing and then following the herds that they had. You have to, of course, link it with the other challenges that the Middle East is facing. And one of the challenges is that the area is the area with the highest level of underemployment, particularly along the rural youth that you have in the Middle East. And compared to all the world regions, MENA has the largest reservoir of rural underdevelopment, and actually the second highest youth bulge. So this kind of underlying issue of not enough employment for the youth will be fueled more and more by climate change and leading it more and more to a vicious cycle. And you can see it here that the averages for the Middle East, both in the ages under 30 and above 30, are significantly higher than other areas, only met by Sub-Saharan Africa.
And when you write Americas, it means the whole South America?
Yes.
Central America, North America?
Yes, yes, yes.
How much is for the North America?
North America? You mean North America?
Yeah, just like Canada and US?
I need to check that. But it's not going to be high, because the closer you are to the equator, the more likely you are to see effects of droughts happening.
And
but the other thing is that a lot of the results that you have are very depending on the type of models that you look at, and there is a big range of uncertainty that falls into that when it comes to different countries. But it's a valid question. Yes?
I have a question regarding one of the slides you showed about the rainfall on Iran. You were showing the mountainous region as being mostly affected by the rainfall and not the so-called Kabir, or you know, the desert area. Thank you.
In this photo, was it this one?
Yes, it's that photo.
The lower one.
If you go up a little bit.
This
know,
one.
Down at the bottom.
This one.
To the right, yes.
Ah, yeah.
Yeah, see the western part of Iran. You're including.
Yes.
Basically, on the desert, on the. The rainfall, whereas that's the mountainous region, you know. And
there is not much precipitation in the rest of the country.
There's nothing.
There's nothing. If you like.
Okay.
So yeah, that's what I was saying. So that climate refugees is actually a very, very hard reality that the Middle East is facing. And we know, of course, everyone knows that there's been so much migration displacement in the Middle East, but actually we have done research and it shows that 10 to 20% of the migration is due to climate change. The other big problem is, of course, food. One of the huge, huge problems, the Middle East is actually the most food import dependent region of the world. Some very chilling and cold facts is that the Middle East actually imports half of its food needs. 40% of rice, 70% of corn, 80% of sugar is already today being imported in the Middle East. And this will increase significantly. So on the one side, we know that it's two sides. On the one side, it will increase with the effects of climate change, but on the other side, it's highly volatile already given to the fluctuations on the global market when it comes to the prices of food. So if there's no climate change, and we're just looking at food price spikes due to the increase of biofuel production, or there are issues in producing food in China and India and exporting it, sorry, the price of rice is projected to actually rise by another 60%. Maize is expected to rise by another 63%. And soybeans are expected to rise by 70%.
Over what period of time?
Over the period of time of, I think, till the year, I would say 2030. 2030 is a realistic target. Yes.
Can you contrast that with Israel's cereal imports? Do you know the number?
No, I don't know them on the top of my head. I wouldn't know that. No. But I can come back to you on that one.
One question. Israel is not at all one of those countries that borrow money from World Bank. Is it correct? I haven't seen that.
Exactly. So Israel falls under an IBRD country. But as far as I know, they don't borrow from the World Bank. No, I think there is some kind of work they're doing on knowledge exchange when it comes to health and education and telecom, but they don't borrow anymore. The other big problem in the Middle East is, of course, the striking feature that it's the high level of urbanization. The Middle East is actually 3% of the region's surface is home to 90% of the total population in the Middle East. It's only 3%. And 70% of the Middle East population will be urban by the year 2020, which is significantly higher than the global average, which is around 50%. This, of course, puts many urban cities into huge strains when it comes to local air pollution. If you just take the example of Iran, the averages for local air pollution in Iran are 4 times higher than the recommended levels from the WHO. It's a huge problem. Egypt is the same. In Amman, the number of days with exceptionally high temperature is expected to increase from an average of 4 days to 62 days in a 2-degree world. So the situation looks very bad. And of course, the other third problem is sea level rise, where we know that a lot of cities that are on the coastal areas in North Africa, when it comes to Tunisia, Algeria, Libya, will face significant rises in sea level. And we've seen that I think the average for the impact of GDP is well above 3% when it comes to the impact for those countries. The last problem, which is quite known actually, is the oil and gas dependency the economies are facing in many of these countries. We know that they have continuously invested in oil and gas, fossil fuel dependent economies, and didn't really necessarily use the opportunity that was available at lower oil prices to divert the economy into non-fossil fuel investments, job creations, other than in these heavy asset industries. That puts them at a detriment now especially in trying to recognize the way forward. Some countries are making a lot of push when it comes to the UAE and Saudi Arabia, actually, to try to decarbonize their economies. But the question is, of course, always how little too late is that, and whether we're in a world where we're actually adapting to the effects of climate change that are happening, or can we mitigate the worst effects? And it's a very different game, and also in terms of money, if we're spending, where to go. So it's not only me that is now trying to preach the truth, and I'm worried when I go to my clients that the Middle East doesn't understand the problems that they're facing. No, actually, they acutely are aware of all the challenges, and they're already showing some leadership in taking action. And one of the ways that the Middle East is showing leadership in action is that as part of the Kyoto Protocol, they signed this document called INDCs, which is this internationally determined contributions to the UNFCCC. So it's a way for every country to say, in order to reach the goals of a 2-degree world, what are the actions we will take when it comes to mitigating adaptation against climate change? And it's also important to say that eventually these documents that they have signed will become binding by the year 2020. So when the country says, oh, I'm going to reduce my zero flaring by X percent, then these are things that they actually have to follow up. So they have submitted, actually, many of them, their INDCs to the UN, and they range in different sectors on the specific tasks they want to take. In the case of Iran, Iran's INDCs, they have committed to mitigate their emissions by 4% to the year 2030 compared to the business as usual scenario. But they have admitted as part of their INDC that they would be actually able to go all the way to 8% depending on the funding that they would need. And the funding requirements stretch anywhere between $17.5 to $50 billion. A year in order to reach that target. Most of the work that they would like to do, of course, ranges around the renewable energy sector, decarbonizing fossil fuel sector, becoming more efficient in the way we're building housing, water sanitation, and kind of also especially on the whole topic of subsidy reform. How can we phase out subsidies completely?
But since Iran doesn't have any cooperation from 2012, you mentioned that Iran doesn't have any, really don't borrow from World Bank, then they don't need to fulfill this 4%.
The INDC commitment is submitted to the UN, that's independent of the World Bank. Okay. This is what every country committed to reaching the targets, the global targets to combat climate change. Of course, the World Bank, and you are rightly so, is the first lender for all this investment in order to actually lead such a transformation when it comes to financing. And we've made three pledges to come how to save, how to combat the climate change in the Middle East. And one of it is first, by the year 2020, we want to increase our funding for green climate finance from 18% to 30%. And so we want to help these countries that signed the NDC to really invest in the specific projects that they mentioned to reach their targets. And we were focusing mostly on water, food security, sustainable, resilient, connected cities, and encouraging the low carbon transition. These are the three headlines that we're really trying to focus on. The other thing, yes.
Sorry. I have a question regarding the UN administration that is denying all of this. How you work with them? How do you encourage them to accept this?
It's a good question. I mean, the thing is that these things are already in place. So they have already come in place before the Trump administration was put into place. Mm-hmm. Of course, there are some political aspects in seeing whether there's going to be a change in direction of the US government when it comes to how much they want to contribute to the COP negotiation process. But the funding from the World Bank, which is a more or less non-political organization, is already sort of put aside.
Is this part of the Paris Agreement?
Yes. Yes.
Is it Chinese big bank also follow this environmental concern, or they just borrow, lend and borrow as they want, the big Chinese banks, international?
I think they've learned a lot from the World Bank. The Chinese clients are very smart. They have been working for a very long time with the World Bank, a lot of co-financing projects. So they know the safeguard requirements of the World Bank in terms of environment and social issues. And they basically made their own version of that for their own project. So from what I've seen, it's a lighter version. It's not as stringent and bureaucratic as the World Bank. But at the core, you see the same skeleton of what they're requiring and the World Bank. So the commitment, too, is to double the share of adaptation financing, which really goes to what I mentioned, to kind of putting more money into the bucket to resist the effects that we already see on the ground when it comes to climate change. So we're going from 28% all the way to 50%. It's quite a big jump that we're trying to do. And then lastly, before I show you a video, it's commitment number 3, which is how we're trying to support the policy reform in different countries in the Middle East. There are many countries such as Morocco, Algeria, Egypt, Saudi Arabia, Jordan, Bahrain, and Iraq, which are embarking on a more resilient diversification path by taking quite bold actions. For example, Bahrain and Oman have recently signed the Zero Routine Gas Flaring Reduction Initiative. It's one of the big initiatives that also now is put in front of Iran to consider aborting gas flaring completely. It's a very, very important step. The World Bank is also very hard pushing for that because it's in the best interest of the country and also for the regional environment. And the World Bank is supporting that dialogue of trying to see how we can best get the Iranian side to come to an agreement with us and how can we best support the country in their path forward. I can go into more detail on these things, but I think the other thing that I wanted to do is kind of show you a little video of 3 minutes of an example of the type of projects that we're doing. But before I wanted to show it to you, I wanted to tell you a little bit about it. So it's about a rural road rehabilitation project in South Sudan. And South Sudan actually suffered through more than 2 decades of civil war, which ended in 2005. And actually, by the time the civil war ended in South Sudan, they did not have one single paved road in the whole country. And that was the year 2011. They didn't have one paved road. There's ongoing sporadic fighting, threat of buried landmines, everything along the way, so there was no way really for anyone to come and actually bring a construction site to build anything. And the old roads had so huge potholes that you will see in the video, they were deep enough to actually stop a Land Rover from continuing to drive in. And in the rainy season, the long stretches were so thick with mud that trucks and people actually could not get through it. So you have to imagine it that there was first a dirt road, then there was a jungle, then there was just mud, and you would have to take on average for 8 to 10 kilometers, it would take you an hour and a half to drive. That's how horrible the situation was. It was getting even worse, the situation, because it was the only access road for the local population. So women would actually die while they were in labor trying to get to the nearest hospital because they could not reach the next hospital in time. And the same was like the agricultural producers were not able to export any of their trade because the road costs were so high. So I'm going to show you a video of that project and how we tried to help the government and a little bit about the realities on the ground and what you can imagine. Can we turn off that light over there? Yes. I hope you see it.
Something. 65 kilo.
I think we can stop here. in terms of time, I don't want to hold everyone too long. But thank you so much for your time, and I'm happy to take any questions now that you may have.